Hi and welcome to Expressions. I'm Julie Robbins. Well, we have a hot delivery for you today because we're at Claude Neon Federal. And if you want to know what that is, well, look behind me. This is what they make. And we're going to take you through all the steps from the time of the planning all the way to the bending of it, the hot procedure, so to speak, as they go through. So stay tuned. We have an exciting show for you. Display room of the Claude Neon Federal building, I like to call it, and we're with James Adair, who is the co-owner of Claude Neon Federal. How are you doing today?
I'm wonderful today.
Now, you call it the display room for obvious reasons. Tell us about it.
Well, this board is the history of the sign business, all the way from 1920-something, when the first lighted sign started, up until present day of what we're doing in manufacturing now.
Right. Now, who is Claude Neon?
In the 1920s, a man by the name of Georges Claude, a French-born inventor, discovered the process of being able to make a high-quality electrode. An electrode is what goes on the ends of each neon unit, enabling it to light up and transfer the gas particles inside the neon tube. And he also discovered that he was trying to separate oxygen out of air for medical reasons. And there were byproducts, which were other gases. And through, like any other scientist does, half through luck and half through guess and trying experimenting, when he took those other gases and put them in this elongated tube, they burned bright colors. And the first color that he discovered was called neon, which is a neon gas. And it's this tube right here. And it's this one right here. It's a clear tube, and the orangey-red gas inside of it is called neon.
Oh,
and
wow.
If you were in grade school and saw on your neon on your charts of gases and whatnot, neon would be one of them, and it's a very common gas.
Now, how long has Claude Neon been in Tulsa?
Claude Neon has been in Tulsa almost 70 years.
Oh, wow. And doing well.
Fortunately, very, very well over the years.
Well, I'm very anxious to get started. I want to see how it works, so we're going to go and start from step one.
Great.
How you get this all going, and you're going to take us through it, right?
Can't wait to show you.
All right, let's go. Now, James, you said we're walking into the design room right now, right?
Yes, uh-huh.
Now, this is where it all starts?
Yes, this is where you take people's or customers' ideas and their imaginations and how they want to identify themselves and their logo and their marketing concepts. You take all their information and you bring it in here. And in here we take ideas of whether it's going to be neon and colors, the metal, if it's going to be painted, the plastic colors. We take all those thoughts and ideas and we try to create the image that they want and how they want to display themselves and market themselves through signage. We go over to the computer.
Where we have a designer.
Uh-huh. We have a designer here. And then he takes all those thoughts and ideas and adds his own. And sometimes we throw it out to him and say, we have no idea what we want. You create it. So whether it's our ideas or his or combinations or clients' combinations or designers or architects, it all goes together and then we create a visual image here on the computer. And then we go back and add the technical design work. What kind of metal, what size, what color, what neon, the thickness, the size, how it's going to look on the building. And then we take all that and we go back to the customer and we say, is this what you want?
And normally they probably say, yes, this is great, huh?
We hope so. We hope so.
How long does this part take?
Sometimes it takes a matter of a few minutes when you already have an idea.
Right.
And sometimes it takes weeks to figure out the concept. We've got a concept right here over here now. They're working on the Sears building at 21st and Yale, the new big redevelopment. It's been here for 2 weeks, and we're still trying to pull information and ideas together for the concept.
Okay, James, where are we?
Well, we're in the art room where we do computer work, and we actually make the patterns with neon on them. What Larry's doing here is taking the artwork from the design that we saw in the other room, mm-hmm. taking the design, this one happens to be for Travers Mahan, which is going to be a clothing store, and he's taking that artwork and changing it into a full-size pattern to make the letters by, to make the metal to hold the neon. And now he's making the neon pattern, so the neon man will make the neon in the right shape and the right size so everything fits together. It's a component part.
Now behind us here, I'm noticing some brass. I know that you're really known for neon, but you do other things also.
Right. Because of the computer and the router and the generators and the craftsmen like Larry over here, we have branched out to do all kinds of things, which are brass, solid brass letters cut out. They could be interior foam letters. It could be plastic. It could be vinyl. And a lot of times anymore, we combine all these different materials into letters. We're now working on a bank sign that's brass letters with neon inside.
And
neon's going to shine upon the building to give it a halo effect.
And, that is neat.
Yes, it's going to be real exciting.
I've never seen anything like that before.
You will on 21st Street by Utica Square.
Oh, that's great. That is great. Well, tell us more about this room. There's so much to it.
Our industry was old and antiquated for many, many years. Not computer-oriented, not material-oriented, or design-wise. And in about the last 4 or 5 years, there's been a whole new explosion. When computer equipment got inexpensive enough for industries like ours to change our whole methods of manufacturing, when young people came along like Larry that took the sign knowledge and background, his computer experience, and we put it all together. And now we're in the process of even updating to the newest and the best equipment available. And so all the work that we do here, making letters, making neon patterns, templates, cutting out letters, making the signs, everything is done and generated on computers now.
Now, what is in the next room here? There's a huge machine.
Yes, it's a router, and there's many small routers. This just happens to be a great big router on a great big table. And when we make lighted letters, like the one that we saw him working on in here, we take the computer artwork from the art room, take a diskette, put it in our new computer. Then from that computer, they send the images and information over to this receiving computer. And then this receiving computer puts the information into our router table.
Well, it's a sure good thing you have computers now, huh?
Absolutely. And then this router will cut all of these letters out. Now, this happens to be some letters that are it's made out of heavy aluminum that will be polished, but right over here, and we may get to see it in a minute, this router also cut out the basic back letters for a bank sign that's going to be in Muskogee. So the computer cuts out all the shapes and sizes and the right background, and then these letters, the backs of the letters, will then go up to Sheet Metal Shop, and they will put the sides on those letters. Now inside all of that is going to be the neon. That's what holds it together. It keeps it together and holds the plastic and everything like that.
Okay, James, this is where they cut and grind, right?
Yeah.
Now, what room are we in?
This is the sheet metal department. And this is where they take all of the pieces of paper and take the pieces of paper, look at them and take the specifications, the sizes, dimensions, the materials, and create all that we've designed. So they put it into a full size and full shape idea. One of the things that we can look at right now is
great example.
When we were at the routing machine and I showed you how they cut out the backs of the letters out of the material, this is what it does. And from the backs of the letters, the craftsman over here will put the holes in here. Now this is for the electricity to come out of the back of the wall into the letter, connect to the neon, which is inside of this, and then go back in the wall and connect back to other letters and then to a transformer.
Oh, wow.
And what we have over here is a craftsman taking these flat letters and putting the sides on these letters. We call these returns. And this gives it depth and gives it strength to hide, to put the neon in there to give it to support and at times hide the neon. A lot of the neon in Tulsa that is made, you never see it.
So you don't actually see the tube, you just see the light from it,
plastic,
is that what?
Uh-huh. Right. Now after he puts the sides on the letters, this is what we have. We have a...
The end result.
This is an A, and so the neon's going to go inside of here, fit real tightly, and then sometimes the neon is exposed without plastic, which in a minute we'll get to see another sign that we did without plastic. This one, however, will have plastic on there. This is for a bank sign in Muskogee.
What is this thing?
Well, it is a great big sign. It looks like that on the ground, and with us standing next to it, it looks very, very large.
Yes.
But one of these days, this is going to appear to at South Roads Mall. You know
the new South Roads Mall.
Uh-huh. And this is going to be one of the signs there. When this gets up in the air, it will not look big anymore. Signs have a tendency to be very large, but when you get them up in the air, they get very small. Now, I will tell you that there's three signs at South Roads Mall, and this is the smallest one. This is the smallest one. The two others will be a lot larger because they're going to identify South Roads Mall, and then down in here, they'll be the tenants on here. So you'll be able to see who is in South Roads Mall and try to identify them by the street.
Well, this is what I've been waiting for. This is where we see the Neon Glass May. And we're with Carl, who is a neon glass bender, is that right?
Yes.
Nice to meet you, Carl.
Nice to meet you.
Now, how did you get started in this?
Oh, about 10 years ago, I changed professions. I had a gentleman offer me a chance to learn how to do it. So I did. I had a lady come in and tell me, or teach me, 2 hours a day for about 4 weeks. And all she taught me was to make squares, and after that, I just took off on my own.
And here you are.
Right, it's a long ways from there.
Now, what are we going to be doing today?
Well, we'll start with this simple letter here. It's a letter F. This goes inside of a channel letter. There'll be a face put over it, so you actually won't see the neon. All it will do is light up the inside of a channel letter.
Right, we saw that earlier.
Right, right. We'll go ahead. I'm going to start with this first bend here. Come around this way. I've already marked my glass, so we'll...
So you're ready to go. Now tell me, what are you putting in your mouth here?
Okay, this is the blow hose. I use this to keep a pressure inside of it that will keep it uniform shape so that there's no shrinkage or swells or anything like that. It'll look uniform as it goes around.
So you have control over it.
Though. Right, right.
Great. Well, let's get started here. Now, does it just melt then?
It just slowly starts getting soft, but you have to get a uniform heat. That distance that I have marked right there, It has to be the same temperature all the way around the full length of it to get a uniform bend.
Ooh, I can see it starting to get soft there. It doesn't take long, does it?
No, not in these fires today.
Now it's starting to turn colors, or the yellow, does that? Oh, wow. You know exactly what you're doing. Look at that. That's great.
Then what we would want to do is from right here, it's what they call a double back. Mm-hmm. We'll just fold it over and bring it back this direction.
What is it here that you're using? What type of fuel or whatever? I don't know the correct.
Natural gas. With forced air.
Which is your air, right?
No, we have there's a pump that's outside that we have air hose that go to these that mixes. Here, we're gonna go ahead and get this.
Oh, that is so cool. Have you ever had one actually break or whatever, what have you?
Many of them. When you first start out, you put a little too much stress on them or something like that, or wait too long to get something that's not quite lined up, and you reach over and you think, I can pull it just a little bit more, and no, it won't go a little bit more. This one here, we're going to do a drop twist. It'll drop it down to come this direction here. So we have to put marks a little bit further apart, heat up a little bit more glass. Now we're going to use this one, this fire here. This one here is called a cannon fire. This is not real old. It's something, the newer tools that we've got from when they started bending glass in the early days, they didn't have that.
Now why are we changing?
Because I want to heat up a lot more space and try not to heat up everything else over here that I've already bent.
Well, you really have to be careful on this one, don't you?
It will burn your arm. now we'll come over here and we'll weld the electrode onto the end of it. Still kind of warm in some spots. All we do is just get them real hot, about the same temperature, both of them.
Oh, look at that.
Now we'll go back down here to the cannon fire and put a double back on it.
Put a double back? Is that what you said? No, what is that?
That's like this bend here.
Oh, okay. Starting, isn't it? Wow. And there we go.
That's one end of it.
If you would like to purchase a videotape copy of this or any other Expressions episode, please send a $20 check or money order made payable to KRSC-TV, 1701 West Will Rogers Boulevard, Claremore, Oklahoma, 74017-3252. Please include the episode subject, your address, and daytime telephone number. If you have any questions, call 918-343-7772. KRSC-TV appreciates your support of public television.
Now that we've got both ends of the glass on, we'll bring it over here, but we've got another unit that's ready to be evacuated, bombarded.
Now, should I evacuate? I see a sign that says high voltage there.
Well, it is high voltage. It's overhead trolley system that has approximately 40,000 volts involved in it. But once we start doing the evacuation part of it, we both have to step back away from this area because it is real high voltage.
Okay.
We'll go ahead and connect this unit up. We got another blow hose we have to use over here. We use a hand torch over here.
Boy, you really have to have steady hands for that.
Just lots of practice. We hook a lead on each end. We try to make sure that they're not touching or close to anything.
Now, is this where we need to move back?
Not yet. This here is a temperature gauge. It's digital readout, which is real new, and it's really a blessing because we've come a long ways. When I first started out, you took newspaper, little strips of newspaper, and you laid them on the glass. When it got up to the temperature that you wanted, they'd turn brown or black, and then you know it was time. We've gone a long ways. But
they're like little battery chargers.
Yeah. Okay. We need to turn my blow hose off. All right. Open the vacuum pump. Down here's the vacuum pump, diffusion pump. It's all of this is top of the line. This is the newest stuff out. All right, now we're going to turn the vacuum on. You can see it pulling down over here. All right, now we're going to shut the vacuum off. And we're going to light it up if it will.
Oh my gosh.
Okay.
Oh wow.
We start watching the temperature.
Now, what are you wanting the temperature to be?
Okay, the temperature, we go in different stages. Like when it gets to 90 degrees Celsius, we'll change the amperage. Then when it gets to 150, we'll change it again. We're wanting to reach the temperature of 230 degrees Celsius, which is very, very hot.
Right.
It's getting all the impurities out. this is lead glass, and as you heat it up, the impurities release from the glass, and with us having a vacuum on it, everything is pulled out. The electrodes are starting to turn red, and we want to achieve the cherry red on both ends of it.
Well, you can tell as it gets hotter, it gets brighter also.
I'm going to increase the vacuum a little bit, and we'll turn it back on. Because when the electrodes get to cherry red, there's nothing on them. Any kind of impurities that's in that metal is releasing. Now I've opened the vacuum back up. All it's doing is sitting there with a constant vacuum on it. And this here is a tour gauge, and it pulls. It shows how much vacuum I'm pulling. Now all we have to do is wait for it to cool down to 50 degrees Celsius. Then we can put the gas into it. This unit here is going to be red, so we'll put neon gas into it.
Okay, Carl, what are we going to see now?
Okay, now we're going to show the process of burning in or aging. It's called different things, but we have a unit that we've just got through going through the process in there of bombarding. When you put the gas into it, the gas may not go all the way around. It may just go halfway, or just, you really never know, because sometimes it'll come right out the color that you want.
So this is a way to test it?
Mm-hmm. And it just distributes the whatever gas that you put in, if you put argon or neon, whichever gas that you put in.
Is this something we need to stand back with?
No. Okay. It's the same process. This here are high voltage lines.
All right.
This is 15,000 volts that's on these. So we'll go down here and turn the switch on.
All right.
It flashes because we don't want it to heat up.
Ooh, look at that. And so this is it. This is the neon light.
Mm-hmm. This here's to the end of where I get to do anything with it.
Well, that's great. Well, Carl, you do a great job.
Thank you.
Well, James, I'm back, and I saw some great neon stuff.
Well, I'm glad you did, because it excites all of us here to make neon and put all these letters together.
Well, he was just saying that now that the neon is done, it has to go into something, obviously.
Right, right. Well, let me show you two things. The first thing is, when we were in the metal fab department, mm-hmm. we made that letter A.
Right.
Okay. Well, what goes with that letter A is the letter A plastic. The computer also cuts this A out. This has paper on it, so the plastic...
So it looks like cardboard.
Right, so the paper doesn't scratch the plastic. Hmm. And this is kind of a unique set of letters because it's clear plastic, and you're actually going to be able to see the neon through the plastic.
Oh, wow.
So you have the neon effect, but yet the water doesn't get in and create water problems. And this is the kind of a new thing that we're doing in the sign industries now, trying to improve the maintenance aspect of neon. So the plastic comes over here. We've got a fabricator like Lloyd that takes this flat pat plastic, takes some material called trim cap that comes in multiple colors, takes it and adds it to the plastic and creates a lens cover, which is the plastic with the sides on
it. It's not very heavy.
And then from the metal letters that we saw put together, the neon goes inside of here, the plastic goes on top, and so when this goes up on a wall with
just
neon inside and lights up, then that's how you see all of the lighted letters in the city of Tulsa.
That's great.
Isn't it neat?
Oh, yeah. Now, I see he's just polishing it up there, gluing?
What we're doing is we're making it watertight. We want to keep moisture out.
Right.
Moisture with neon is very hazardous, and it's also...
Well, I would say, moisture with any electrical.
Right. That's
you'd
right.
really have to...
But in neon, it's high voltage. And so there's an extra little care and concern that we have here at Claude Neon to try to make sure that the signs burn for a long time and we don't have any maintenance problems with them.
Now, how long does it take to put one all together? I know you said it depends on the size of the sign.
It depends on the complexity, the size, specifications, anywhere from several weeks. But like the Southwoods Mall project will take 3 months. Now, Julie, before we go, I'd like to show you one of the products and signs that we make that kind of puts all of it together. All the patterns, the neon, the metal letters, the transformers, the wiring, and this is a finished product. This sign for Mazzio's has been reworked with different colors, And this sign will be on the 11th Street location by tomorrow evening. It will light the skies of Tulsa for the weekend.
And it will make the stomachs growl because it's
light
right
so.
Now.
I hope so. If we're doing our job and our part of it, they'll be happy.
Well, James, thank you so much for being on the show and giving us the grand tour here.
Well, you're certainly welcome. It's a great opportunity for me to be able to tell you and anybody else that cares about the sign business and what makes it work, what makes it happen, and the love of my life.
Well, you know, the whole saying is, if you love what you do for a living, you never work a day in your life, right?
That's close. Thank you.
Well, thank you. And thank you for watching Expressions.